Welcome back to the Book of Genesis. Of course, let's welcome way back. We're doing the primordial history, as it's sometimes called. I remember in the thick of the fundamentalist takeover of the Southern Baptist Convention a few years ago, the head of the convention said that if any man doesn't take Genesis 1 through 11 literally, he doesn't belong in the ministry. And I thought to myself, if anybody does take it literally, they belong in the insane asylum. And we're discovering that step by step as we go through the book. Pardon my ecumenical French. Well, right, we had just finished the endlessly fascinating chapter 3, the second half of Jay's creation account, the Garden of Eden story, and I won't reprise that. You no doubt remember it well enough. I'll only say that it resulted in the man who, henceforth, I suppose you could refer to with a proper name, Adam, even though it's the same as the Hebrew, Ha-Adam, the human being, and his wife, named Eve. They're now out of the Garden of Eden. They don't just live a leisurely life of picking fruit off of trees and suntanning. Now they gotta work hard to get that food from the ground, and the difficult art of agriculture has begun, and other things begin as well. Eve conceives a son, and the whole human race goes downhill right out of the starting gate. I mentioned that the story of the Tree of Knowledge, etc., was not taken by many ancient Jews as the origin of sin. Later Christians did. I said Jews had a different notion of the origin of sin, that it came in as a result of the bad influence of the philandering sons of God intermarrying with mortal women, etc., and we're going to get to that. But another one was another possible entry point for evil had to do with Cain, the first human being born. And as we'll see, that also can be read as a kind of a parallel to the sons of God story. Now, stay tuned. We'll get to that pretty quick. So again, it's up to you whether you want to take Adam in Genesis 4:1 as a name or as generic the man, but what the heck, might as well use the name. It's got to start in here somewhere. Now, Adam knew Eve, his wife, getting to know you. Of course, this is one of those 10 places where to know clearly means carnal knowledge, or the knowledge that they derive from the tree. Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten, Hebrew, kana, a man with the help of Yahweh. Well, there's one of those etymological stories, right? They called him A because they said A prime, and it's a pun. In fact, there are other puns and other stories about the origin of the name Cain. But here, of course, is based on the Hebrew word to get kana. I've gotten a man with the help of Yahweh. Now, that's interesting. Because in the previous chapter, it's a little odd to think of the help of Yahweh here, since he's the one that set the hurdle she had to jump. He certainly didn't give her the knowledge of how to conceive. He was trying to keep that a secret. And then once they wrested it away themselves, the man and the woman, what does Yahweh Elohim do? He says, okay, but you're not going to enjoy this. I'll increase your pain in childbearing. So in what sense did he help her get this man-child, this firstborn son? Well, the ancient rabbis, it seemed, wondered about that too, and some of them. Now, this is just amazing to me, but I guess it shows some textual critics do have imagination. Some of them thought, Trio, this sounds a little odd. It must be a textual corruption because, as it stands, it implies that Yahweh might be the father of the child. That might be the help. Might be in the first of those many places where a woman is unable to conceive, and she suddenly does after a visitation by the angel of Yahweh, who is pretty much the same as Yahweh in human form, a theophany. Now those, I think, are just thinly veiled Hebrew versions of these Greek myths in which it's the God having taken human form sexually impregnates the woman. And the demigod is born as the result. And there's something of that in this guess. They're saying, wait a minute, it sounds like it's saying that, that that's the help she needed so that this boy who was born, Cain, is the son of Yahweh. So wait a minute. And I have to say, you know, there's something to that, though I have always assumed all Eve means is, well, that was a tough one to get through, and thank God I managed to do it. I'm assuming that, but you can really see how somebody might read it this other way. But some of these ancient rabbis said, now, if that's what it means, it's out of the question. No, that can't be. Geez, I wonder if the text originally might have said, I have gotten a man with the help of Satan? So maybe that's the way it ought to be. In fact, there was a traditional list that the rabbis at some point compiled of probable textual corruptions and emendations that they offered. That doesn't mean they had any manuscript support for them, mind you. It was one of those places where in the footnotes of the RSV would say, construction, Hebrew text obscure, where they said, we don't know what the writer was trying to get at. The text is a mess. It's been messed up somewhere along the line in copying. Could have meant this? That's what translators of the Quran are doing all the time. But at any rate, that's kind of what these scribes were saying. It wasn't that they couldn't make any sense of it, it's just that what sense it made didn't make any sense. Yeah, I know it says that, but what on earth? And there must have been other sources for this too, but this was one of the bases on which some of the ancient scribes came up with the idea that, what is it we read about Cain? He's a murderer, and he displeases God. Gee, I suppose this could have anything to do with him being the son of the devil? You New Testament fans out there said, that kind of rings a bell. As indeed it does, for in 1 John we're told not to be like the murderer Cain, who was the son of the evil one. Maybe this idea went far and wide. Apparently it did, that Cain was demonic, that he was not a demigod, but a demi-devil, sort of already an antichrist figure. That is what I mean when I say that this story could be taken as a parallel to that of the sons of God and the daughters of men. And there are other stories, too. This interlocks with some stuff we read in some of the Enoch literature and so, whereby Life of Adam and Eve and some of these other pseudepigraphical books that say that when Satan was thrown out of heaven for protesting God's directive that all the angels worship Adam or bow down before him, then Satan decided he would show that he had been right, that Adam was unworthy, and so he would show how easy it was to tempt human beings off the path of obedience to God, and he seduced Eve, perhaps in some disgusting manner, through the mediation of a snake or whatever. There is that, and that fits into this too. That's yet another piece of the puzzle. This is what some scholar, I forget who, calls a scribal myth. it's a legend that is actually wittingly created by an author, a scribe, but created as a midrash in order to get out of a tight spot, to say, well, all right, there are a lot of dots missing. We like to connect the dots and explain this. I guess I'll just have to supply several of the dots hypothetically. And so a new story grows out of the old. Originally, of course, Satan has nothing to do with this. Remember, at the most, you can, and I think should, identify the serpent with Nehushtan / Leviathan. Another god in the Jerusalem pantheon, but Satan has nothing to do with this. He doesn't come into the story. But later on, my point is, they began to combine characters. In fact, this might be a good place to mention Lilitu. She was a folklore character, the night hag, and she was their explanation of SIDS, sudden infant death syndrome. A baby just dies inexplicably. What happened? They'd say, well, Lilith came and sucked the breath out of him. And who was that? Well, eventually somebody got a bright idea. Hey, wait a minute. Notice this contradiction between the story of human creation in Genesis 1 versus that in Genesis 2. We saw this, how Genesis 1 has men and women made it all at the same time. Well, at least the ancient readers said it's got to mean at least a man and a woman. Guess that must be Adam and his wife. But then why does Genesis 2 have Eve made subsequently? What's going on here? And they figured they could harmonize that if they said, all right, Adam is the man, unnamed, but mentioned in the seven-day creation account. His wife there was not Eve, but Lilith. She was the first human being created. However, she didn't get along with Adam. She wanted equality. He didn't want it for her, and so she left him, and eventually wound up as the bride of Samael, another version of Satan, again, you know, later on. And then God created Eve, Adam's second wife, sort of a Stepford wife. So interesting, that's another one of these scribal legends where you tell a new story to try to harmonize old ones. Interesting. Okay, so the birth of Cain was read by some as meaning the birth of a half-devil. I mentioned there are other etymologies for Cain. In fact, Cain is really a pun with the Hebrew word gotten, kana. It seems to mean more likely a forger of metal, a metallurgist, metal worker, whatever you want to call it. And sure enough, that version of it is attested later on, chapter or so, when we read about Tubal Cain, who forged weapons of bronze and iron. Well, that's somebody's picking up on that derivation. There's another version of it where someone sees a similarity between Cain and a Hebrew word for stalk of grain, and has the newborn infant Cain run over and grab an ear of corn and bring it to mommy. And because of that, they name him Kone. Which reminds me of a great joke a friend of mine, Kevin Bossman, used to tell at Gordon-Conwell Seminary about how Billy Graham's cooperative evangelism program drew the line at Cornelius Van Til because he couldn't go along with presuppositionalism, and he imagined the summit meeting between them. I can't work with you, Connie. I think of Cain as little Connie, and because the same name, like an ear of corn. Well, all kinds of these guys didn't need much to build it into a story, and where am I getting these? Well, they come out of, I don't just make them up, believe it or not. The lore of Judaism and the Bible just has all kinds of stuff like this, the kind of thing that did wind up in the Bible, but since nobody stopped making it up, there's loads more of it that was made up a little too late to go in, or it had already been made up, but they could only accommodate so much and left a lot of it out. And indeed, I think there are occasions where legendary material we read in the Mishnah, and well, not so much the Mishnah, I guess, but the Midrashim and so forth, the commentaries and such, and in the pseudepigraphal books, preserve elements of the ancient myths that were censored and edited out here. I mentioned last time some of the Gnostic documents of Nag Hammadi, like the origin of the world, the testimony of truth, the hypostasis of the archons, and so on. These books have other versions of the Genesis story, which seem to me less Gnostic rewritings and more preservations of the original polytheistic background of it. Well, we're going to see some more of that stuff, and especially in the chapters we're looking at today, there's some interesting possible background. But let's get back to the actual text. It's established in verse 1 that we do have Cain as the very first offspring, right? The first man ever born. Adam is made from the dust of the ground. Eve is made from his rib or his side or whatever. This is the first one actually born. If you apply the structuralist method of Claude Lévi-Strauss to this, that raises a very interesting question about the Cain and Abel business. But it also goes back through the whole J creation account of the Garden of Eden, too. It's the agenda that Lévi-Strauss detected as the deep structure of the Oedipus cycle. He said, if you interpret this, given his methodology, you find out that below the actual plot, there's a set of oppositions that were the mechanism by which pre-logical man sought to mediate dilemmas that occurred to him. He couldn't rationally solve them, so he narrated a story showing conflicting elements personified. And in this case, he said what Oedipus was really about was the attempt of it was about the attempt of early man to overcome the primitive fairy tale belief that human beings were born like vegetables directly from the ground, and to get over to the adult belief that humans are born from humans. The way Lévi-Strauss put it was, born from one, from Mother Earth, versus born from two parents. Born from another, the Earth, which really isn't much like us, versus born from the same, human beings like us. We have a hard time with that, and sure enough, you do find numerous references to the Earth Mother and so forth. I remember noticing in one of Juvenal's satires, he said, way back when men were born directly from the earth instead of from parents, etc. This seems to go back to a point in the awakening sophistication of primitive tribes, and they first make the connection that sex is responsible for children. It isn't obvious that it's so, right? Not every act of sex brings forth children and so on. And so you wonder, like little kids do, you know, what causes kids? Is it your parents kissing? Or does the stork bring them? Or do you find kids, babies under cabbage patch leaves? Oh, now there you go. That's what Lévi-Strauss said. That in a primitive sort of a way, deep down we think of that, and we are directly from Mother Earth. But we find out that, well, no, not really. We're born of sexual begetting, and Roman Catholic Church, which is we weren't, but we are, and we have to come to grips with that, and yet we feel we have betrayed the original belief that we had as kids, and we feel guilty about that. So what do we have? We have stories in which the different characters' names are code, and what happens to them are code, and just to skip to the punchline, Oedipus seems to be about the price paid for affirming that humans are born from other humans and not from the earth. The price paid for denying the denying Mother Earth and your, quote, true origin there. How is this? Well, it shows people symbolically giving their names with characters with, like, Oedipus means club foot and stuff like that. Characters whose names imply they walk the earth with difficulty. And the fates of characters losing their lives when they esteem human relation too high or too closely, so that Oedipus ruins everything when he unwittingly kills his father and marries his mother, and others die out of loyalty to family members and so on. All right, you can claim to belong to a self-begetting series, and you can succeed, but that involves you trampling the earth, which is your true mother, and she's not going to let you get away with it. Kind of strange, but a pre-plot logic of what is happening deep down in the telling of the Oedipus story. Well, I think he's right, and I think the same thing can be seen in the Genesis story, the J version of it. Remember how just about everything is created from the ground? The only thing that isn't is the woman, Eve. She's created from the same. She is born from another human being. And then the first one born in the sexual manner of begetting, Cain, kills his brother. And why? Well, he is a farmer who brings forth life from the ground, who attacks a man who is a breeder of sheep, animals born from the same kind, other animals not from the ground. And then what happens to Adam and Eve? They are cursed and exiled from the ground from which he came, sentenced to return to the ground from which he was brought. And what happens to Cain? He is cursed to wander the earth and never to be able to settle. Eventually he does, but that's another myth attached to him. But there is this repeated idea that as the human race decides to believe and to act on the notion we give birth to ourselves, that is the knowledge of good and evil, we deny creation, that God made us from the ground. Philosophically, as Tillich says, it seems to me we must transcend our origin and rebel against it if we're to be true to our own potential, so that the fall is a part of the creation. But to me, theology is fascinating, even if you're an atheist, maybe especially if you're an atheist, you get that objectivity. Anyhow, so I've anticipated what's going to happen, but you knew it anyway. So, back to Genesis 4:2. Again, she bore his brother Abel, which looks like another form of the name Baal. Now, Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a tiller of the ground. In the course of time, Cain brought to Yahweh an offering of the fruit of the ground. And Abel brought of the firstlings of his flock and of their fat portions. Now this kind of thing is going to be mandated in the Torah, you know, much later. And this might be considered one of those places where Jay shows his lack of discrimination, his sense of anachronism, assuming that the first humans already knew about the sacrificial laws really, that came about much later. But at any rate, they're both offering, you know, the first fruits of the crops, firstlings of the flock. And again, both of these things are commanded later on. So it's a little puzzling why, as we see now, God turns his nose up in one of them. And Yahweh had regard for Abel and his offering. He acknowledged it. Right? But for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his countenance scowled. Yahweh said to Cain, "Why are you angry, and why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is couching at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must master it." Now, where is Yahweh? Is he actually in person standing in front of Cain and Abel? Well, yeah, probably so. I imagine, given the way we've seen Yahweh interact with Adam and Eve before. But, you know, you could imagine, well, no, he's talking to him in a dream. That would work just as well, you know, take your choice. But what did Cain do wrong? It's as if, I think, Yahweh is saying to him, "Look, why are you mad? Are you blaming me? It's a simple matter. You're accepted if you do the right thing, which you obviously didn't do. Now, don't go down this course, because sin is lying in ambush for you. It wants you. It wants to devour you. Don't let it. You must master it." This is some kind of weird harking back to what Yahweh said to the woman. You might think to avoid the pain of childbirth by shutting the bedroom door on your husband, but your desire will be for him, and he will be your master. I don't quite know what to make of that yet, but some other version of the same kind of thing. He's like given Cain advice. He's not condemning him outright, but we still don't know exactly what Cain did wrong, and here is a theory about that. It goes back to an ethnological myth. This may be one of those places where something is not explained because the writer or the storyteller figured it would be manifest to the readers or hearers. They didn't really need it. And now that's always dangerous to try to fill in that blank, but this is a pretty good attempt at it. The theory is that Cain, who's especially in English transliteration, sounds kind of like the Canaanites, stands for them and their agricultural-based worship, which involved what the prophets would later condemn as immorality and idolatry. They worshipped Baal, whose semen the rain was, and it fell down and inseminated the womb of Mother Earth. And to encourage this to happen in a magical fashion, the farmer would go make a contribution and sleep with the temple prostitute, the priestitute of Baal, and the old-time religion. Hosea and these guys just can't stand that stuff. And they long for the purity of the nomadic worship of Yahweh. They look back at the nomadic past as the golden age when there were none of these temptations. Of course, others looked at it just the opposite way, right? Like Amos does, but Jeremiah said, "Oh, the desert days—that was the honeymoon period." Well, this would come from that standpoint. Cain would stand for the agricultural fertility cult worship of the corrupt Canaanites. Well, you have to ask why God doesn't like this. Better left tacit. Whereas Abel would symbolize the nomadic ideal That's what nomads did, right? They had herds of sheep and cows and camels and stuff like that. And so, naturally, God's going to accept what they offer because he's the God of the desert who was their deity. This would mean that the story came from that particular faction, somebody like the Rechabites that Jeremiah knew, and who wouldn't, they were like the Amish of ancient Israel. They would have nothing to do with farming, etc., or with trade, which they thought was just as corrupt and based on farming. And so I'm guessing this is a Rechabite tale. And again, it just symbolizes, it doesn't exactly say that today's good guys, the Israelites, are descended from Abel, because it says nothing about him having any kids. There could have been such a myth, but nothing is said here. He gets killed, right? So we don't know that he's supposed to be their ancestor. And the Canaanites, well, he could be their eponymous ancestor, same name ancestor by a pun, or he could just be the type, like a political cartoon symbol. But at any rate, that's one major theory and a major example of an ethnological tale. And so the story isn't over. Now, what follows here in verse 8, the murder, the fratricide, does not necessarily follow as the original continuation of this sacrifice competition between the two brothers. It does fit, but it could stand on its own as simply the story of the first murder. Now, the Brand X comparison of sacrifices makes a good backstory. It provides narrative motivation. So it now gives us an idea of Cain's envious motivation, but originally you might not have had that and wouldn't really have needed it in verse 8, but read it whichever way you want. Cain said to Abel, his brother, "Let us go out into the field." And when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then, I don't know how he did it, We have an intimation later in another version of this with Tubal Cain, a forger who must have used new metal weapons he had invented to do the job. Here, I guess we have to assume he beat him to death with a corn stalk, which would have been pretty tough to do, but at any rate, killed him. Verse 9, here is a parallel to Yahweh in the garden. Hey, where is everybody? Verse 9, then Yahweh said to Cain, "Where's Abel, your brother?" "I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper?" Yeah, this is where that comes from, right? This is one of the many cliches from the Bible, only it wasn't a cliche yet. How do I know? What are you asking me for? Am I in charge of the guy? Verse 10, Yahweh said, "What have you done? The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. And now you are cursed from the ground." Here we go, Lady Strauss, here we come. "Which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand." So, it's going to, you know, it's just like in the Garden of Eden, right? "Did you eat of that tree I told you to keep your meat hooks off of? Well, all right, here's the sentence." Same thing. And the ground is cursed because of you, to Adam. Same thing with Cain, only he's cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. Verse 12, "When you till the ground, it shall no longer yield to you its strength. You shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth." Now that's interesting. Adam was told, no more picking the fruit off the trees in your tropical paradise. You're out of here, and from now on, you're going to have to sow the seed and harvest the vegetables, and it's not going to be easy. Well, Cain is used to that. He is a farmer, but now he's being denied that. You'd rather be working the land, but get out of here. You're going to be a fugitive. David Jansen, right? So you can try to confute me. You can try to till the ground, but you'll find that it doesn't give you any good food anymore. You'll give up. You shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth. Cain said to Yahweh, "My punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, thou hast driven me this day away from the ground, and from thy face I shall be hidden. And I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will slay me." Well, what's this about? Here is another ethnological story. Cain now stands for the Cainites. In fact, his name in Hebrew, his name is Kenan, the name of, more like Kenites than Canaanites. And the Kenites, allies of David later on, some of them were wanderers and nomads and nomadic raiders, attack your caravan and so on. How'd they get that wandering lifestyle? Why don't they just stay home like everybody else? Well, they're descended from a murderer who was made into a wanderer as his punishment, kind of like a wandering Jew. And so that's why. It's an ethnological story. So Cain, again, says, "My punishment is greater than I can bear." He appeals. Now, what's he afraid of here? He says, "Whoever finds me will slay me." Who's he thinking of? Who's going to seek him out and kill him? His mom? His dad? That's kind of it so far. Unless, of course, there's more of the story than survives. This might be a tip of an iceberg here. There might be a lot more going on in the background that the narrator just does not like to tell us. Maybe he is thinking of some sort of vendetta, though it's a little hard to imagine if he's the only son of Adam and Eve, if they're going to take revenge by killing the only one they got left and starting over. At least he seems to think so. Well, then, but then again, that could point in another direction. Maybe this story implies that Cain is not the first man. Maybe the story implicitly pictures Cain as living in a somewhat later time when the earth is ordinarily populated, I mean, like it is today. Or in the ancients' time, maybe there, because he says, "Whoever finds me in my wanderings," maybe that kind of lets out his own immediate family. "Even if I go far away, I'll be defenseless, a man without a country. People will take advantage of me, kill me." So that kind of implies a later time. It really does in a moment. Keep that in mind. We'll see something else here. Well, God considers this appeal and makes an adjustment. 15. Then Yahweh said to him, "Not so. If anyone slays Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold." And Yahweh put a mark on Cain, lest any who came upon him should kill him. Now, how is that a mitigation of what he has said and of what Cain is afraid of? He says, "Oh, don't worry. If somebody kills you, so-and-so will happen. Hey, look, I don't care what's going to happen after they kill me. I'd like to see to it that they don't kill me." Well, that actually is the point of it. He says, "Don't worry. People will know not to kill you because of this mark that will notify them, oh, stay away from this guy. You know who he is. You know the rule. If you kill him, or anybody with this mark in this tribe, the Kenites, they will see to it that seven of yours die. You take that as the beginning of a vendetta, you'll be sorry, because no matter how many of them you kill in retaliation, they will kill seven times that many of yours, so steer clear of this one." It's not an individual who's involved in view here, it's the Kenites. And one might ask, wait a minute, what could God put on him as a mark that would tell everybody this? I mean, you know, what's he going to have, a small print tattoo? Warning, anyone who slays this, anyone bearing this mark, will have seven of his killed. No, this is all written retrospectively. It's yet another ethnological legend saying, well, you and I know in our day that the Kenite marauders, identifiable by their distinctive tattoo, practice this sevenfold vendetta thing. So whenever we see somebody coming with their mark, let's get out of here. So it's that people knew it from experience that whoever bears that mark, whatever it is, some tattoo that you can see at a distance. Let's take another way. So the mark itself is not an intelligible signifier, except that it lets you know who it is and you have heard what they do. Again, that doesn't make a lot of sense if you take this literally, but that is certainly what they're trying to say in this symbolic story, as if it was written out there in detail. What was the mark? Well, they don't tell you, because here certainly is a place where they figured you'd know. Oh, you know, the tribal mark of the Kenites. We've all seen it, so they don't bother telling you what it is. But people that didn't realize that, some of the ancient rabbis said, oh, maybe it was red hair. Maybe it was a unicorn horn, etc., etc. Yeah, maybe. Well, all right. So he gets the mark and leaves. Verse 16, then Cain went away from the presence of Yahweh and dwelt in the land of Nod, which means wandering, east of Eden. Well, notice he said he didn't want to leave the vicinity of God. From thy face I shall be hidden. This is going to be like a story of Jacob we read later on, where he goes to a place, a holy place called Peniel, face of Elohim, a place where God supposedly revealed himself to pilgrims. Well, there in Eden, the very garden of Yahweh, says, you're kicking me out of here. I mean, my parents were kicked out of being in the garden, but we lived adjacent to it. I can't even be here in your presence, your penumbra anymore. Well, that's right. So he was driven away from the presence of Yahweh and dwelt in the land of Nod. Now, Yahweh is certainly in charge of what happens, but this implies they did not yet think of him as being abstractly omnipresent. Even St. Augustine had a tough time explaining that hundreds of years later, a Platonic philosopher, and he had to say, well, God can't literally be everywhere. That would localize God and mean that God is parceled out. No, it must mean that God is present to everywhere, etc., etc. They weren't thinking of that kind of thing in the ancient world. That's why this is myth, not theology, not philosophy. The land of Nod, the land of wandering. Well, that apparently means, yeah, he did what God said. He went out and wandered out to the east of Eden, which might mean in Persia. Well, who knows, since Eden must have been in Iraq, Mesopotamia. Of course, it's possible there that, well, see, there's a, I guess what you might have in mind is that he lived like a nomad, and it's kind of like the wandering in the wilderness in Exodus. They're not really making any time getting anywhere, so that in a sense they are living in one place, but it's a huge area and they're wandering around in it, and I gather that's what's being said here. He has no one place to live, which is originally the point of that gospel saying, Hugh saying that foxes have holes, birds have nests, but the Son of Man, as the human being, has no place to rest his head. Alright, Cain gets busy begetting in verse 17. Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bore Enoch, and he built a city and call the name of the city after the name that Cain built the city, call the name of the city after the name of his son, Enoch. Who's he building this city for? Who's going to live in it? If we now have a grand total of four people and then his son, five. And where'd Mrs. Cain come from? I'm sure you've thought of that one before. Once again, we know we're not being told the whole story. Did God create several different people? Well, yeah, if you go with Genesis 1, you don't have a problem here. God and the gods, male and female, created a bunch of humans, male and female, at the same time. So you don't have incest right off the bat, right? Well, maybe this particular Cain story implies some kind of creation like that. Who knows? Remember, Jay was like the Brothers Grimm, gathering all manner of stories and then putting them together as best he could. Maybe this one did not presuppose that all human beings came from a single couple. Right, so, and this is almost to say the same thing. Maybe this story comes from a cycle of Cain stories that didn't really take the trouble to work out any consistent chronology. Cain was a figure of some fascination, a resourceful hero, or anti-hero, whatever you want to call him. And people may have just naively told stories, placing him in different historical settings. Have you ever watched Xena, Warrior Princess? And wondered, now, when the heck did Xena live? How old exactly is Xena? Well, by my count, and I certainly haven't even seen most of the episodes, she's got to have been something like 1,400 years old. Because isn't Xena at the fall of Troy? And she meets Julius Caesar? And she meets Galen, the physician. Wait a second! She meets David and Goliath? I mean, this is a span of over a millennium! And they're just figuring on, it's a safe bet, they're figuring on the abysmal ignorance of the public. She lived in ancient times. If I remember correctly, Prince Valiant was the same sort of thing. And he's dealing with classical Greeks, with Muslims, with Vikings. I sort of like that kind of thing. It's just storytelling. But then that's what Cain would be. Oh yeah, he's the first man born, and he built the first city for whom? Just for himself and Mrs. Cain and little Enoch? That's, you know, got a lot of extra space where there's room to grow, I guess. So he's the head of a city. Now, does that remind you of anything? What do we know about this man? He, number one, killed his brother. Number two, founded a great city. That sort of reminds me of Romulus and Remus. Same sort of thing, the city founder, who somehow has to found the city on the blood of his brother. Strange. Interesting possibilities. These myth patterns percolate through the whole Middle East. And don't tell me you haven't thought of that one before, though. So, okay. Let's get to some genealogizing here. We're reading the priestly version. Verse 18, now Genesis chapter 4, verse 18. To Enoch was born Irad. I'm probably butchering these. I don't speak Hebrew. I'm just sort of giving you the King James version. And Irad was the father of, or begat, Mahujael. And Mahujael, the father of Methushael. And Methushael, the father of, or begat, Lamech. And Lamech took two wives. The name of the one was Ada, the name of the other Zillah. Ada bore Jabal. He was the father of those who dwell in tents and have cattle. his brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all those who play the lyre and pipe. Zillah bore Tubal-Cain. He was the forger of all instruments of bronze and iron. The sister of Tubal-Cain was Naamah. Lamech said to his wives, Ada and Zillah, hear my voice, you wives of Lamech, hearken to what I say. I have slain a man for wounding me, and a young man for striking me. Notice the disproportion in there. If Cain is avenged sevenfold, truly Lamech 77-fold. Well, we can't pass by this one too quickly. Here we have another version of the Adam, Eve, Cain, and Abel scenario. It's not too hard to see that. Only we've got the two wives, just like Jacob will have. Now, Jabel sounds kind of like Abel. Indeed, he is another version of Abel. And he's a nomad. He is the father of those, that is the founder of this way of life. He's a culture hero of those who are nomads. They dwell in tents, that is, they're wanderers. You don't dwell in a tent if you live in one place all the time. And you're a wanderer because you have cattle that are grazing and given them. You know, the topography of the place, you got to go from one oasis to another. Now, doesn't that kind of describe old Abel? Yeah. In fact, how can this man be the father of all those who follow this practice if Abel already was? It's not clear if they're trying to make a literal genealogical claim here. He's the one that started this way of life. Well, I suppose you can harmonize it with the Abel thing earlier in chapter 4 by saying, well, all right, Abel died, they had to start over. But this sounds like he's the first one, and of course he is because he's the same character. Just another version of the same name. And that explains who the young man is who was slain by Lamech. I have slain a man for wounding me, a young man for striking me. Who was available must have been Jabel. Only his father killed him, not his brother. But his brother, Cain, this time Tubal-Cain, supplied the weapons, and his father did the job. That's why all these elements are mentioned together. You have to connect the dots, but they're there to connect. They're there as hints. They're just telling the story very tersely. Tubal-Cain, the forger of all instruments of bronze and iron. Okay. You see what's happened? This is how his father Lamech is able to take disproportionate vengeance for mere blows or insults. This is how he can kill all out of proportion beyond the fiendish fury of Cain. A mere 7? Oh, I can get 70. 77, actually. This is the shadow side of the gospel saying, how many times do you have to forgive your brother who offends you? Oh, but 7 times? No, 77 times. Or you could translate 70 times 7. I'm guessing it's 77 times in the week that story, that saying is based on this. Well, so here is, I say, another version. This time, the brother gives the father the weapons to kill the other brother. This, in turn, reflects the unseating of Uranus by his Titan children, Cronus, Creus, Iapetus, etc., etc. And we're going to find yet another version of that in the Bible, too. But this is another dramatic playing out of that myth. now it's interesting that we're going to have a whole different story about Enoch and Lamech, etc., in the next chapter, which is P's alternate version of all this stuff. But notice that after we have Lamech, I want to tell you one other thing about Tubal-Cain. He is implicitly pictured as the father of the metallurgists of ancient Tubal. In Ezekiel, you have references to this guy, to this nation. In fact, you know it, don't you? If you don't, can't think of it right offhand, you will be mad at yourself once I read you this. The famous Gog and Magog business in Ezekiel 37 and so forth. See, 37 is the dry bones thing. Yeah, here's 38. The word of Yahweh came to me, son of man, set your face toward Gog of the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal, and prophesy against him and say, thus says the Lord Yahweh, behold, I am against you, O Gog, chief prince of Meshech and Tubal. I will turn you around and put hooks into your jaws, and I will bring you forth, and all your army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed in full armor, a great company, all of them with buckler and shield, wielding swords. Persia, Cush, and Put are with them, all of them with shield and helmet, etc. That's because they're allied with Tubal, the metal-working tribe, and their ancestor was Tubal-Cain. That is the original Cain, no doubt. So that's where he comes from and who he's supposed to be. That kind of rules out this fundamentalist fantasy that Tubal is really the same as Tobolsk, and that therefore this is a prediction of the Soviet Union. Oh, my God. I mean, it's not that it couldn't have anything to do with the name Tobolsk. That's not my point. It's just that Ezekiel is talking about an ancient nation, not a modern one, one that was around in his own day. And that's another question. We'll have to do that another time, another course. Okay, but what we got here? A replay of the scene in which one of the brothers is killed. Jabal is killed. Now, who's the other guy? Jubal. We don't really hear much more of him, but think of the word jubilation. Well, it's no accident. Jubal was the Middle Eastern god of music. And it's common in myth patterns that as time goes by, a character who was simply one of the gods originally becomes demoted and humanized into an ancient hero or a founder figure, etc. Well, that's happened here. Is the father of all those who play the lyre and the pipe. Originally, well, yeah, the god of those, the divine patron. Okay. So, replay of the killing of Abel by Cain, and the author uses that as a segue to go into the immediate aftermath of the first Cain and Abel story. Right on the heels of the second version of the Cain and Abel story, we go back to the aftermath of the first, verse 25. And Adam knew his wife again, and she bore a son, called him his name Seth. For she said, God has appointed for me another child instead of Abel, for Cain slew him. To Seth also a son was born, and he called his name Enosh. At that time, men began to call upon the name of Yahweh. Now, have we actually seen anybody do that before? Let's take a fast look. I don't think so. even though it says Yahweh is addressing them, I don't believe that we have any character refer to him as Yahweh. And in fact, think back to the woman and the serpent. They both speak of him simply as Elohim. So I guess this is where the addressing or the invocation in prayer, I guess it'd be the same thing. We only speak of prayer because God is not immediately with us, right? And but here they can call on his name. Now, who are these people? Well, Seth begins to take on an almost messianic character in Judaism. In fact, in one of the Adam legends, we're told that as Adam, hundreds of years later, lay on his deathbed, he prevailed on Eve and Seth to go back to Eden and ask for a bite of the tree of life so that Adam wouldn't have to die. And the angel there says, I'm sorry, God's not going back on his sentence, but here's what he will do. You can have this branch and plant it, and it will grow and later become the miracle working staff of Moses to save your people, and after that the magic wand of Solomon. And as you know from there, it became the staff of Solomon Cain and Robert E. Howard and so on. Actually, according to the Christian version of the legend, because they had one too, it would become the upright shaft of the cross of Christ. And so it's a tree of life in another sense. Interesting stuff. I just love this, the evolution of these legends. And the Nag Hammadi, well, it becomes a whole Seth religion. Several of the Gnostic texts from Nag Hammadi are from Sethian Gnosticism. They believe that the line of Seth and the line of Cain were really metaphysical entities, and the line of Seth were what they called the Cainless race. They knew no human master, at least not within, not inside, and they were the true Gnostics. And the sons of Cain, or sons of the evil one, were always trying to attack them and such. Seth becomes... the Gnostics will say that Jesus was the second coming of Seth, that Seth appeared again as Melchizedek, and would appear eventually, and had appeared eventually as Jesus, and would come back. Fascinating. That's the mark not of a kind of heretical Christianity that creates a new backstory, but rather a type of Jewish Gnosticism that eventually decides to join up with Christianity and simply grafts Jesus onto their own myth. There was a similar Melchizedekian sect, which must have already done the same thing, fusing with the Sethians, and they accepted Jesus as the reincarnation of Seth or Melchizedek. Fascinating. The Mandeans spoke of Seth and as well as one of the archangels, and also the man called his son here Enosh. They called him Enosh Uthras, the glorious Enosh. The name Enosh means in Hebrew man. When Jesus speaks of the Son of Man, it's Bar Enosh, or Aramaic Bar Nasha. I never wound up seeing the movie Golgotha Chainsaw Massacre, also known as The Passion of the Christ, by Mel Gibson, but I was tempted at one point when I saw an ad on TV that showed Jesus speaking in Aramaic, as he does throughout the film, and he said one of these Son of Man sayings, I think the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, etc. And he's there saying a bunch of gibberish to my ignorant ears, but suddenly there it is, Bar Nasha. I thought, wow, that might be kind kind of fun to see this guy playing Jesus actually speaking Aramaic. But I didn't go see it anyway. But so Enosh, the man, and we're told that he's one of the heavenly saviors in Mandeanism. Oh boy, there's a lot going on. But I think I can surmise something else about Enosh. I'm willing to bet, and you can tell me about this if you go to heaven and they have that big seminar everyone is always talking about, that when we go to heaven we'll find out this and that. You know, I know people for whom that would be hell, but I agree, that would be heaven. There in the house of study with God as the rabbi and explaining all these things. Oh man, would that be great. You know, I like to tell my students that that myth can be a case of realized eschatology. The idea that there are all these mysteries of the Bible that await explanation. Listen, you don't have to wait till the sweet by and by. I can tell you right now a lot of these things. Because biblical criticism has found answers to a lot of this stuff that fundamentalists have never heard of or don't want to know. Like we're going to get into the lifespans of the patriarchs in a little bit. We don't have to wait till we get to heaven to find out. No, I can tell you right now where all that stuff came from and what it means. You may not like it, but I can tell you. That is one of the great things about getting into this stuff. Oh yeah, we'll have to wait till we get to heaven. No, no. In fact, I was talking once to the great Haim Maccabee. It was the great privilege of my wife and myself to host him and his wife, Cynthia, to dinner in our home some years ago. And the great Dr. Maccabee was telling me that there's a list of exegetical mysteries that the rabbis say, yeah, that's pretty tough. I tell you, we're just going to have to wait till the prophet Elijah comes to solve this. And he solved one of them. This guy said, well, I guess you must be the prophet Elijah. Well, if there's a, you know, if there's a good candidate, I guess Dr. Maccabee might have been it. May he rest in peace. But now he's up there in heaven answering all the questions, right? So I think that, you know, that is one of the most amazing things. Yeah. We actually do know significantly more about these things. We don't know some of the big ticket ones, like, is there anything after death? But we can compare what the Bible says about that in different places. And that in itself is a kind of an answer, a kind of a we'll never know until it's too late. But anyway, okay, here's my surmise about Enosh. He must have been the original first man in Hebrew mythology. He remains here, shunted aside. A good example of Martin Note's redundancy principle. When you see a character on the side of the stage with nothing left to do, really, and there's some sort of a hint that he once held a central place, you begin to think whoever is on center stage now has replaced this character. Well, here's what I think happened. Enosh, whose name means man, must have been the primordial man created in Hebrew mythology. But the one we read about now was originally the Edomite first man. The Israelites borrowed Adam from the Edomites. That's not just a pun this time. Remember, if I haven't told you before, all Semitic languages are based on three consonant roots. You have three consonants that may occur in any order, but they're the three of them together indicate a certain range of meanings that words built upon them will reflect. There aren't any vowels written down. You just learn how to say things, and eventually they do create vowel points. We have points to punctuation, but we have separate letters for vowels. Well, Hebrew, Arabic, etc. had punctuation for for vowels. And that means that you often have words with more or less the same consonants but different vowels, and it's just a matter of different usage. Like terrorist devil, bin Laden. What's his first name? Depends on what network you watch your news on, right? Is it Osama bin Laden or is it Usama bin Laden? Doesn't matter. The vowels are secondary. Different people would say it different ways. In fact, with this one, you can take it back in history and find all different versions of it. Uthman, Osman, O-S-M-A-N, and the Uthman was one of the caliphs of Islam. All of these are cognate with Osama, Usama, etc. Well, it's the same sort of thing here. Edom and Adam are simply the same name. And it goes on to fit even more snugly, because Adam means the red earth. And, of course, he's made from the ground, so that whole story must be an Edomite myth. Why is the character who is actually said in Genesis to be the ancestor of the Edomites not called Edom, but Esau, Esav in Hebrew? Why is that? Because he's pictured as a caricature of your average Edomite, as Israelites viewed them. Big, muscular, tall, strong, stupid, and hairy with red hair. Esau is certainly the prototypical Edomite. Why is he not called Edom? Well, because that would mean he'd be called Adam with no difference, and that character had already been borrowed. I mean, in the Edomite myth, when Adam, or Edom, was created from the red earth, that explained the red hair, and the Edomites were the first nation, the direct offspring of the first man. All these nations give themselves that privilege, right? They're either the first, or the central, or the real human beings, etc. But their cousins, the Israelites, borrowed this. They liked the story better, who knows why, and it displaced the Aboriginal Hebrew first man myth, in which it was Enosh. And so in their stories, they kept Enosh on the side, but it would be centuries before anybody did anything with him again, when he becomes a Gnostic redeemer. And they adopted Adam or Edom as their first man. And then they couldn't use him as the father of the Edomite nations, because they were not going to say the Edomites were the original human beings. So they decided, okay, the Edomites enter the picture centuries later, and their father is this other guy, Esau. Well, he came in real handy, because he also was red and had a beard, because Esau was a sun god. And in fact, he was a sunset deity, which is why his long hair, the rays of the sun, is red instead of blonde. All civilizations had more than one sun god, depending on what the sun looked like and where it was, whatever time of the day. So you had this musical chairs thing going on in Middle Eastern mythology, and so that's who Enosh was. He becomes, again, as I say, real important as Enosh Uthras in the Mandean religion. And I believe, in fact, John the Baptist is said to be the earthly incarnation of him. And again, the Son of Man thing in the Gospels, there was a lot of thought in the 60s and 70s that Son of Man mythology goes back to primal man mythology. Gayamard, the primal man of Zoroastrianism, Purusha, the primal man of the Rig Veda, the Adam, and so on and so on. The Son of Man is the primordial man who underlies the guff. You ever see that fascinating movie from the 80s, The Seventh Sign? not the Bergman movie, The Seventh Seal, but the movie with Demi Moore and Jürgen Prochnow and various others, where the end of the world begins and the seven seals of Revelation are opened, and Christ comes back to earth to warn this woman who is pregnant that the guff is empty, G-U-F, the storehouse of souls in heaven, and her baby will be born without a soul, and that will signal the end of the world, kind of like in Revelation, you know, the end will come when the last scheduled martyr has been killed. Well, here, and they do have that in the movie too, but the signal for it all to end is this soulless baby, because the guff is empty. And in a climax that will make you reconsider your views about abortion, even the mother's life being at stake, Demi Moore, who turns out to be a reincarnation of Mary Magdalene, refills the guff by being willing to die for her infant. It's a heck of a flick based on this great complex of mythology, and that's what the primordial man was. All souls were contained in him. All the future human race, and in this movie, he finally runs out of people until we get a reprieve because the guff is full again. What a fascinating idea and a fascinating movie. The Seventh Sign. Okay. Enosh. And at that time, men began to call upon the name of Yahweh. And call on his name, well, that could mean a lot of things. Invoking it as an oath, praying, personally praying collectively, but apparently they weren't using the name Yahweh. This in J contradicts both the E and P sources, because they're going to say that Yahweh had not been known by that name until the time of Moses, but here, of course, it says, oh no, it started way back there. So here we have the J version of the pre-flood patriarchs, the generations. Now we want to get into the priestly version. And it starts out in 5:1 with one of the signature lines of the priestly writer. This is the book of the generations of Adam. Or these are the generations of Adam and the earth, the generations of Noah, etc., etc. When Elohim created man, no Yahweh, right? The priestly writer doesn't use that until Moses' time. Let's just say God, but it's Elohim. When God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. Male and female he created them, and he blessed them and named them Adam when they were created. I got the Revised Standard Version here. It says name them man with a capital M. Some ambiguity here. What does he mean, name them? Well, collectively, I guess, as a species. But then, wasn't the first father of the human race in the J account called Adam? Well, that's a big hint, I think, that all of this stuff is symbolic. If you got a guy named Man, it's like this wrestler named Mankind. Well, who knows what the heck's going on in the mind of the wrestling thing, like in Woody Allen's Hannah and Her Sisters. Imagine the level of a mind that watches wrestling. Well, anyway, here it's pretty clear, right? Naming them humanity. We're not talking about an individual Adam and Eve, but we will be in a minute. So, male and female, he created them. Does this not sound like the priestly creation account, the six-day or seven-day creation account? Made them in the likeness of God, male and female. 3. Now, our priest here loves statistics. When Adam had lived 130 years, he became the father of a son, or begat a son, in his own likeness after his image, and named him Seth. the days of Adam after he became the father of Seth were 800 years, and he had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and he died. Not a bad lifespan, right? Still not much more than a micro click on the cosmic clock, but who'd be complaining? Verse 6, when Seth had lived 105 years, he became the father of Enosh. Seth lived after the birth of Enosh 807 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Seth were 912 years and he died. Hold on a second. Didn't we just read in the J version that Seth was the immediate son of Adam and Eve? He replaced, presumably, the childless Abel. There's no sign of Abel here, but we do have the same sequence so far. Adam, Seth, Enosh. But let's see what happens next. 9. When Enosh had lived 90 years, he became the father of Kenan. Well, that's Cain. That's just a slightly different spelling of the name. In Hebrew. Now remember, according to J, Cain was the direct son of Adam and Eve. Here, no, he's the son of Enosh, the son of Seth, the son of Adam and Eve. So there's no doubling back in this one. All of the names are along one string. Same names, but with a different family tree diagram. Verse 10, Enosh lived after the birth of Kenan 815 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Enosh were 905 years and he died. Holy mackerel. 12. When Kenan had lived 70 years, he became the father of Mahalalel. Kenan lived after the birth of Mahalalel 840 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Kenan were 910 years, and he died. When Mahalalel had lived 65 years, he became the father of Jared. Mahalalel lived after the birth of Jared 830 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Mahalalel were 895 years and he died. Mahalalel is the same as Mahujael in the first list. Methushael is the same as Methuselah, whom we haven't got to. Jared, obviously, is the same as Irad. These are all just slightly different versions and spellings. Now, lifespans in the J version, plenty lifespan to go around in the P version. So, let's get back to it in 5:18. When Jared lived 162 years, he became the father of Enoch. Whoa, now wait a minute. Enoch was right after Cain in the first one. He was all out of whack here. Jared lived after the birth of Enoch 800 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Jared were 962 years and he died. When Enoch had lived 65 years, he became the father of Methuselah. Enoch walked with God after the birth of Methuselah 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, and he was not blank, for God took him. When Methuselah had lived 187 years, he became the father of Lamech. What? Well, wait a minute. No, this is all different, right? You've got these the same names, but different sequence. 26. Methuselah lived after the birth of Lamech 700 and 82 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Methuselah were 965 years, and he died. Before we go into Noah, who comes up next, what's the deal with Enoch? Well, he was a figure of enormous interest in ancient Judaism. He was the culture hero who invented writing and was therefore depicted as a scribe, and that makes him equivalent to Cadmus in Greek mythology. And before that, he was the sun god, another one, right? And you can tell that quite easily because of these clues, which you really have to be an idiot not to see. Right? I mean, they're really just poking in the ribs here. He lives 365 years. And it's pretty obvious that here is a blow struck for the solar calendar. Oh boy, did they used to debate over calendars, which one now to follow. They used to have church splits and heresy accusations over this kind of thing. Even now today, as you know, some of the Orthodox churches have Christmas and Easter a week or a couple of weeks later than everybody else. I always wonder how those little kids feel and so on, because they can't agree on the darn calendar and so forth. Well, that was a big thing in the ancient world, and only Barbara Thiering understands how big a thing it was. She brings all this calendar lore up in her fascinating books about Jesus, Qumran, Nag Hammadi, and so on. I don't think anybody else has the faintest idea of why this stuff is important. She may be wrong, but I'll never know enough to know better. But she at least has picked up on the importance of it and tried to make some sense out of these mentions in the Bible. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. But at any rate, you've certainly got the solar year there in the life of Enoch, the sun god, and it takes that long to have a solar year. What happens to Enoch? He was not, which I assume means he wasn't to be found, pretty much like the prophet Elijah, because what happened to Elijah? He ascended up like a booster rocket in the sky aboard a fiery chariot, and he was, that means he's the noonday sun, and that's what happens to Enoch too. He rises into the heaven like the sun does each day, and he walked with God. Now, where does God walk? Well, we know from Exodus, he walks on the outside of the sapphire pavement of the firmament. So that if you go up high enough on a mountain, as Moses, Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, and Jethro did, you can eat with them. You can have a picnic lunch with God on the roof of the world. So if Enoch walks with God, well, of course, on one level, it means he was very righteous. If I'm walking with God, I don't go where he wouldn't, and so on. But on another level, wink, nudge, he is making the circuit of the heavens in company with God. He is the sun. Well, just as the sun God gave laws, Enoch gave all kinds of revelations. In later Enoch works, and there are loads of Enoch revelations floating around, he is transfigured when he's taken into heaven and given a flaring human torch body, and he maketh his angels a flame of fire, etc. You know the drill. And that is so, again, to say he's the sun god. And it's tough to get around that. Well, he goes up. Well, once again, they demote the gods into the form of ancient culture heroes and demigods, and that's what's happened here. In Genesis, he is depicted as a human being from before the flood, way back there. So he isn't a sun god anymore, but the traits indicate that's where they got him, right? in his form as a legendary, epic, human hero, who is he? Well, again, he's the scribe who invented writing. And he's the flood hero who is given immortality by being sucked up into the heavens like Elijah was. Where am I getting this? Well, in the Encyclopedia Biblica, somebody who actually knows their Hebrew, says that it sure would fit if it were Enoch, not Noah, who was the Hebrew flood hero. And in fact, the two names have been confused, because if you take off the E, which is on the end, not the beginning in Hebrew, what would you have? Well, you would have Noah. They're almost the same name. This comes through even in English. We distort all the names, of course, anglicizing them. And when you speak of the laws God gave to Noah at the end of the flood, what are they called? The Noachian commandments. We pronounce the name Noah with no terminal H, even though we spell it with one, but they aspirate it in the in Hebrew and so forth. So it'd be Noachian. Well, same sort of thing with the name Noah itself, and that's just missing the Hebrew equivalent of E, which is Enoch. And so the theory is, and I buy this, I think this has got to be right, that originally the Hebrew flood story featured Enoch as the flood hero. And one big reason for thinking this is that in the Gilgamesh epic, that version of the flood, the hero Utnapishtim, and I'm going to read you this the next time, Utnapishtim gains immortality by heeding the warning of the gods, building an ark, saving the lives of the basic animal stocks, and refurbishing the earth once the flood's over. They reward him with immortality, and he becomes, in effect, one of the gods. Same thing in the Babylonian version, where Xisuthros is the flood survivor and is given immortality. This fits in very well with the original identity of Enoch as a sun god, because he triumphs over the flooding rain. So once the sun comes out again, that's telling you that the sun god managed to end the flood and the threat posed by the storm, etc. Can I say that that's one reason for thinking that Noah was not the flood hero, but that Enoch was? Well, in that case, who was Noah? Who was he originally? Now let's take a fast look at the story of Noah, and then the next time we will look at the flood story. But got to do a little jumping around here in the Bible first. Okay, we last saw Enoch here in Methuselah, and then Lamech. Okay, in Genesis 5:28, when Lamech had lived 182 years, he became the father of a son and called his name Noah, saying, "Out of the ground which Yahweh has cursed, this one shall bring us relief from our work and from the toil of our hands." Lamech lived after the birth of Noah 595 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. After Noah was 500 years old, Noah became the father of Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Let's just jump over the flood story for the moment and look at the Noah incident in chapter 9, after the flood. Chapter 9, verse 20. Noah was the first tiller of the soil. That's odd. I thought that was Cain. But not here. There's another one, right? These stories were independent, just put together like a patchwork quilt. Noah was the first tiller of the soil. He planted a vineyard, and he drank of the wine, and became drunk, and lay uncovered in his tent. They see him there naked, and we'll leave that to another time, but this is enough. Noah was the first tiller of the soil. He planted a vineyard, and he drank of the wine, became drunk, and lay uncovered in his tent. Boy, what did Lamech say with his prescient knowledge of the great future achievement of Noah, on account of which he named him Noah? This one will bring us rest out of the ground which Yahweh has cursed. Remember when God said to Adam, okay, no more picking the fruit off the trees, now you're going to have to get it out of the ground, and it's not going to be easy. Well, God cursed the ground because of them. And Lamech says, well now, if it's not going to change, at least my son will bring us relief from it. And how does he do that? By inventing wine. Right? You're there at the end of a hard day of sweaty labor farming, and it's Noah time. You get out the wine, and the wine maketh the heart merry, etc. So you kick back and enjoy yourself as you rest, thanks to Noah. He's mitigated the curse of the land by inventing wine. All right, now, I'm not much of a wine drinker myself, but I could see that one would see that as a major cultural achievement. But that's the main thing this guy would be known for? I mean, this kind of reminds me of this thing where the amazing Randy went over to Russia to expose some psychics who supposedly could tell you all about a person by looking at their photograph. So he gives them a photograph of Richard Speck's mass murderer. They never heard of the guy, and they're looking at him and they say, well, he liked music. Well, Speck did happen to like music, but that's really not the main thing about him, is it? I had no suspicion that he was a serial killer. Well, same thing here. Lamech knows the future with the 2020 hindsight of the omniscient narrator. And he sees that the big achievement of his son Noah is to invent wine? How about saving the human race? Well, of course, the point is, the teller of this tale did not know of Noah as the flood hero. He must have thought it was somebody else, and you know who that was, or he had no flood story. That's not unlikely. If you just think, you know, if go back earlier in the priestly genealogy, if you got a guy who is the father of animal husbandry, and another one who is the father of today's musicians, and another one who's the father of today's metallurgists, you're not thinking of a flood that destroyed civilization, after which people had to start over. You mean to trace a direct continuity between these culture heroes and their counterparts in your own day in an unbroken succession. There's no flood allowed for in there. Here it is in the next chapters. So apparently the original flood story hero was Enoch, not Noah. Noah was the little old winemaker, and so we're trying to undo these little confusions. All right, I mean, it's obvious now as we read it, it is Noah, but the story has changed, that's my point. Still not going to go into the flood this time, it's a little too lengthy to do that, but I do need to get into the major question, though it is fairly easily solved, of the lifespans of the pre-flood patriarchs. Now, let's see if we can get through this intelligently. I think we can. Fundamentalists are stuck making up scribal legends, even as the ancients did. They don't know what to make of this, so they come up with wild hypotheses like, well, maybe there used to be a vapor canopy that over the earth that weeded out the sun's rays so that people didn't age. Yeah, they lived for nearly 1,000 years apiece. That's because they're stuck with a literal reading of the Bible. I'm not trying to say the author didn't mean it literally. It's just that it can't reflect reality if taken literally. And yet, here there is even room to doubt the intent of the storyteller, the priestly writer, to narrate unvarnished history. I don't know what he intended, but there was some sort of a symbolic meaning behind the lifespans he allots to the pre-flood patriarchs. I say some. It's not absolutely clear what it is in most of the cases, but let's see what we can make of this. It appears from Assyrian documents that our priests might have had access to in Babylon during the exile, that there was a list of the Babylonian kings who reigned before, well, it's a Babylonian list of the kings that reigned before the flood in the Middle East, including Gilgamesh and others. Let's see if we can get through this. So there were the same number of kings as there are patriarchs in both the J and the priestly lists. The names are even cognate, just as we've seen J and P have the same names reshuffled and in slightly different versions, like Carl and Charles, right? Jim and James, that kind of thing. Even so, this Babylonian list has names that are cognate. They look less like it, but based on the same roots and stuff as the same names. These guys are not merely patriarchs, but they are kings of a bigger population. And they lived many times longer, tens of thousands of years in a grossly mythic framework, right? The pre-flood kings reigns are totaled, and it comes out to 432,000 years. Only those are not the units they used. They counted them into five-year periods they used, called SOSes, in English, S-O-S-S-E-S. So the combined history of the reigns, the successive reigns of the pre-flood kings, lasted for 86,400 sosses, or 432,000 years. Well, apparently the priestly author did not know what a sos was, though he could read the language, and he just assumed that it was the same as a Sabbath in Hebrew, which is the week. Or, perhaps he did know what a sos was, but figured that was altogether too long and simply decided to substitute a Sabbath for a sos. At any rate, he converted the Assyrian soses into Hebrew Sabbaths or weeks and kept the same number of units so that he has 86,400 weeks. And the total of that in years is 1,646 years, and that is the combined overlapping lifespans of the patriarchs. The same number of units, but different units, so that the unmanageable Babylonian king list duration of 432,000 years shrinks to the overall lifespan of the patriarchs as 1,646 years. That's, again, the span from the birth of the first one to the death of the last one. It's not adding up all the lifespans. It's adding up the total span over which these people lived. They overlap by hundreds of years at a time, as you've noticed, right? It gives us all that very clearly. Well, that can't be a coincidence. That has to be where it came from. Now, how did they determine, the old Babylonian priests, how long the pre-flood kings had reigned? Who knows? My guess is it had some astrological root. Well, we don't know what the priestly scribe thought either, but he apparently broke up the total into particular lifespans based on something he knew about the characters Now, he doesn't tell us enough about most of the characters for us to recognize what he's doing, a kind of numerical pun. But there are two of them, right? You already know what I'm going to say, don't you? Enoch lived 365 years, and he stands for the sun, so that it's really 365 days in a year. That just has to be. Equally, you cannot tell me it's a mere coincidence that Lamech, in the priestly account, is said to have lived 777 years, and the J genealogy has him say, if Cain be avenged sevenfold, surely Lamech 77-fold. 777. Coincidence? I don't think so. Again, if we knew more about these other guys, I'm sure these other things would leap out at us too. But I don't really know. Of course, a little tough because in all the different old manuscripts, these numbers tend to differ, like they kept correcting them. My guess is that they figured out sort of different Kabbalistic meanings and adjusted the text to them, but I'm just going on the version of it that is printed in our Bibles. Surely the Enoch and Lamech things call the tune for the others if we only knew more details about it. So, do we know the mystery of the pre-flood patriarchs' lifespans? Well, basically we do. I don't know that we can crack the Babylonian code, why they arrived at the numbers they did, but it's no big mystery that they would simply say, oh yeah, these god kings like Gilgamesh and Nimrod, they lived hundreds and thousands of years. Yeah, sure, why not? But in terms of the Bible, yeah, we know where this comes from. Not from a historical memory of men living nearly 1,000 years apiece. They never did. It comes from appropriating this Babylonian legendary and chopping it into kind of Kabbalistic statements about the pre-flood patriarchs. I think the case is about as closed as we can get it. We don't have to worry about vapor canopies and people living all that long. They didn't. This is where it came from. Right, I know you got a taste for mythology, and let's finish up this time with another little wild goose chase that gets us nearer to the flood story. Another barnacle on the hull of the flood. Not into Noah yet, or into the flood itself, but a story that the compiler has taken and added to a little bit to tack it onto the flood story to try to plug a gap. Why would God flood the human race out like rats after having created us? Well, obviously, we must have done something to royally piss off the Almighty. Why? Well, we were all wicked. Well, that's still no better explanation why that happened. You don't mean to tell me God created a bunch of louts and rascals and villains? How'd the human race get so bad? Well, you already know that some people said it must have been that Cain guy. He must have been half devil. But this one is one that has a little bit a more immediate application. Maybe the human race was genetically and morally corrupted by a certain act. Hey, I got this old story over here of an intermarriage between gods and mortal women. Let's use that. Okay, originally this story was not about that. This is the story of the sons of God and daughters of men, a J's story in Genesis 6, 1 through 2 and 4. Number 3 is a redactional addition. As you can tell very easily, right, this is not some wild-eyed critical hypothesis, pretty obvious. When men began to multiply on the face of the ground, and daughters were born to them. Now, already, you notice, this does not presuppose Adam and Eve or anything. It's an origin story in its own right. Once upon a time, in the days when there were, when you first had a lot of humans, when they were getting, you know, gaining strength and the herd was getting bigger, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were fair, and they took to wife such of them as they chose. I'll skip verse 3. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came in to the daughters of men, and they bore children to them. These were the mighty men that were of old, the men of renown, that is, the old epic heroes, Gilgamesh, Goliath, Nimrod, these guys that were of superhuman stature and power. Goliath is said to have been 6.5 feet tall. King James makes him 9.5 feet tall, but that's a corrupt text. Still, you know, most people were pretty shrimpy in this era, since they didn't have enough meat to eat and so on. So these guys that were very tall must have been semi-divine. These ancient heroes must have been demigods. That was the only way to account for their mythic exploits. Or if you had modern people like that, it's the only way to account for their great stature, and they did. So this story is about the ancient demigods who kind of got weeded out of the Bible, Samson being another one, right? It explains where they came from. Now, who are the sons of God? Well, they're mentioned in the Psalms. This religion was not originally monotheistic. El Elyon, God Most High, had all kinds of offspring, 70 of them at least, and Deuteronomy 32 tells us that when God divided the human race into nations, he counted his sons and then made that many nations so that each nation would be worshiping one of his sons. And in the divvying up, Yahweh requested Israel for his fiefdom, and they worshipped him as the God of Israel. Well, it's these various gods, they impregnated mortal women, and the result was the heroic demigods. And, it says, the Nephilim were around in those days, and also afterward. Well, why say that? They're reapplying the story to explain very tall people. Numbers 13:32 is a reference to this. I know you're thinking, wait a minute, there can't possibly be anything interesting in the soporific book of Numbers, and you're pretty much right, but here's an exception to the rule. I mean, it is a real snooze fest otherwise, but Numbers 13:32. Pages are disobeying me here. All right, there. They've sent out, Moses has sent out spies to do reconnaissance on the land of Canaan, and they give an ill report, most of them. 31, they say, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. So they brought to the people of Israel an evil report of the land which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we have gone to spy it out is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature, and there we saw the Nephilim, parenthesis, the sons of Anak, who came from the Nephilim, close parenthesis, scribal explanation, and we seemed to ourselves like grasshoppers, and so we seemed to them. I mean, like we're, you know, we come up to their knees, we might say. There's no way we could beat these guys. So these huge people in Canaan, the scribe says, well, yeah, they were descended from the Nephilim, the ancient demigods and so on. They come in for mention again in Deuteronomy 3:11, which is kind of a recap of the J and E history. and they conquer a guy that is supposed to be one of these giants or a descendant from them. They conquer the cities of the kingdom of Og in Bashan, for only Og, the king of Bashan, was left of the remnant of the Rephaim. Behold, his bedstead was a bedstead of iron. Is it not in Rabbah of the Ammonites? 9 cubits was its length, and 4 cubits its breadth, according to the common cubit. That was 18 inches. The wonderful wizard of Og. He was the last of the Rephaim, same as the Nephilim. Job speaks of the Rephaim as being in the great Tahom, in the subterranean ocean where lost souls go. Here it's a reflection of the Greek myth, where Uranos has consigned some of his children, the giants, the hundred-handed, and other monsters, underground. And in the New Testament, we have fallen angels consigned to the nether darkness. Same myth. In Tartaros, they use the same Greek name. Well, here's the same myth again. These giants, when they died, were consigned to the nether world because they were the sons of angels, sons of God, later considered to have been fallen. So they're talking about actual people they knew of that were so tall and mighty that they figured they must have been descended from the demigods, latter-day survivors. First Samuel, here's a whole mess of them. A squad of these guys. For Samuel 17, we have David and his buddies fighting the Philistines. Well, Goliath of Gath, he was 6.5 feet tall. I won't read you the whole story, but that's who he is. And then Goliath, there's another version of the Goliath story in 2 Samuel 21, 15. And following. This is interesting. This is not the one you hear about in Sunday school, because it's not David that kills him in this one. This, therefore, has to be the earlier one. 2 Sam 21:15. The Philistines had war again with Israel, and David went down together with his servants, and they fought against the Philistines, and David grew weary. And Ishbibenob, one of the descendants of the giants, whose spear weighed 300 shekels of bronze and was girded with a new sword, thought to kill David. But Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, came to his aid and attacked the Philistine and killed him. Then David's men adjured him, "You shall no more go out with us to battle, lest you quench the lamp of Israel." But First Officer Riker telling Captain Picard, "You can't go down there with us, you have to stay on the ship." 18, after this, there was again war with the Philistines at Gob. Then Sibbecai, the Hushathite, slew Saph, who was one of the descendants of the giants. And there was war again with the Philistines at Gob. And Elhanan, the son of Jareorigim, the Bethlehemite, slew Goliath the Gittite, the shaft of whose spear was like a weaver's beam. And there was war again at Gath, where there was a man of great stature who had 6 fingers on each hand and 6 toes on each foot, 24 in number, and he also was descended from the giants. And when he taunted Israel, Joseph the son of Shimei, David's brother, slew him. These 4 were descended from the giants in Gath, and they fell by the hand of David and by the hand of his servants. Does that give you any clue as to why these guys actually were that huge? And I'm not dismissing them as myths. I mean, it could be, But this could be based on popular heroes that were venerated by the Philistines. In fact, I just bet one day we're going to dig up some document written by the Philistines that sings the praises of Goliath of Gath and his buddies. Well, again, they're not that huge. If Goliath is an example to go by, 6.5 feet tall, but why were they so much taller than most shrimpy guys back then? Well, the last one tells the tale. This guy had 6 fingers and 6 toes on every hand and foot. He was a pituitary freak. That's what happens. That's one of the marks of giantism when you have endocrine problems. So this looks like they happen to retain a hint of what was really going on, though they didn't understand it. But we now do, since they didn't know about genetics and endocrine glands and such. They just figured, well, I guess it was a mixture of divine and human. These guys must have been demigods born of mortal women and begotten by the sons of God, ultimately. Fascinating. Now, once they start in the Deuteronomic reform, trying to streamline the pantheon so that Yahweh and El Elyon are not son and father, but rather the same God, they make the sons of God into angels, and then this story has to be reinterpreted so that it is wrong for the sons of God, who are now angels, to mate with mortal women. And so this can be used as an explanation for how evil entered the world. If the angels had been good, there wouldn't have been any evil entering the gene pool or the bloodstream. But of course, the good angels wouldn't have shacked up with these gals. So if they did this at all, they must have been immoral, fallen angels, and so that's all tied in together. And in the Book of Enoch, and the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, the Book of Jubilees, all these pseudepigraphical books outside the Old Testament, you read details about this, so that it says that the sons of God taught martial arts and weapon making to men, and arts of seduction and cosmetics to the women. And so everything that both sexes do that is wrong was taught them by their angelic initiators. And this is why the human race went so bad, so quick, when God noticed and said, "What the hell is this? You know, this is not what I had in mind. I'd have never created the human race if I'd have known they'd come to this. Tell you what, I'm going to flood them all out." And so, it comes in quite handy. And so between the introduction of Noah at the end of the priestly patriarchal genealogy and the beginning of the flood story, our compiler has placed this old story rewritten, much like the golden calf story was rewritten to serve a new function. And he's also added a little tack in there to put it in place and to comment on a major change that is going to take place in all the rest of the chapters, namely having to do with the lifespan. Because, again, the pre-flood patriarchs would live to nearly 1,000 years. That's going to be over because the legends henceforth, reported in Genesis, are about people pictured more in our mold that have realistic lifespans, because they're trying to create verisimilitude, right? They're trying to make them more than cartoon characters, so they have to be pretty much like us with our limitations. So here's the verse tacked into the middle. Let's read the whole thing again, but with this middle part. "When men began to multiply on the face of the ground, and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were fair, and they took to wife such of them as they chose. Then Yahweh said, My spirit shall not abide in man forever, for he is flesh, but his days shall be 120 years. The Nephilim were on earth in those days. Doesn't seem like that fits, does it? It just interrupts the context. Because it's trying to tie this into the new context in which it's been placed, the flood story. And to do that, it says, okay, I've had it, from now on, they're going to live no longer than 120 years. No more of this 969-year stuff. Why? Well, because the stories, you know, weren't about people that lived that long. So they have to have some narrative motivation for the changes. It doesn't just drop off. 120 years, though, who lives that long? Moses. He's said to live 120 years. And he becomes a kind of a paradigm, but much later, Yohanan ben Zakkai, who reorganized Judaism after the Roman War, he is said to live 120 years, which is a way of saying he was a new Moses. And the brother of Jesus, Simeon bar Cleophas, second caliph of the Jerusalem church after James the Just, Simeon bar Cleophas was said to have lived 120 years. Not that he did, it's just Moses imagery. So they're already trying to make room for Moses here. Everybody else is not going to live nearly as long as Mahalalel and all these clowns did. Moses will be the longest lived one. I think Terah lives a couple of hundred years, but at least it's the father of Abraham. But they're rapidly declining to the point where no one will live that long. They live, as Psalm 90 says, about 70 years, or by strength of 10, 80. By reason of strength, what was it? 80. I think it says 60 or 70. I just looked that up. I can't believe I've forgotten that. Psalm 90. The years of our life are 80. That's where I got the 10. Or so 70 years, or even by reason of strength, 80. Yeah, we live, if we're lucky, 70 years, or if we're really in good shape, 80. And so that kind of puts to rest the idea that the ancients all lived only till 40, and they were old men. Just that such a